terraforming Mars. So the transformation of Mars from the current hostile dry and cold desert into a world which could support life will be one of the biggest mega projects for humanity in the next centuries, if set in motion. But the key question, of course, is terraforming Mars even possible?
Could we even do it with a technology that we currently possess? Or let's say, with a technology that is not in the realm of the extremely far future? Or is it absolutely impossible after all? Well, let's try to analyze the major obstacles and see if there would be a way to overcome them in order to terraform Mars.
In the last episodes of the JS Space Report, we already talked about the pros and cons of first colonizing Moon versus first colonizing Mars. If you have missed those videos, we will link to them in the description down below. What would be the next step after we have established huge cities on Mars? Let's say that at some point, the future Mars government, under the rule of the benevolent Elon mind-uploaded AI-merged overlord, would decide that it was time to start a mega project of terraforming Mars. We know that we are involuntarily very good at Mars-forming Charon. It is evident that humanity can have a big impact on an entire planet. We have demonstrated that ability on Earth. So it's only logical to assume that we could do something of a similar magnitude also on Mars, albeit into the opposite direction, of course. The idea of terraforming Mars was put forth by Carl Sagan already in the 60s, even though he first proposed to terraform Venus. Venus is another highly interesting topic, by the way, and we will certainly do a separate episode on terraforming Venus. Later, Carl Sagan visualized Mars terraforming in an article called The Planetary Engineering of Mars, published in the journal Icarus in 1973.
Later, other scientists picked up the idea, with the term terraforming first emerging in 1982, coined by planetologist Christopher McKay for the Journal of the British Interplanetary Society. Since then, many problems and obstacles have been analyzed in countless scientific papers, which we would need to overcome in order to transform Mars into a life-friendly planet. 1. Increasing the density of the atmosphere. Mars's atmosphere is, as we know, really thin. It consists of 96% CO2, the rest being argon, nitrogen, and traces of oxygen. The median pressure is only 0.61 kPa on average, with the highest pressures in the very low-lying plains reaching a maximum of 1.2 kPa. This is way below the Armstrong limit of 6 kPa, below which humans need pressure suits in order to be able to survive. Now, in order to walk on Mars without a pressure suit, so with only an oxygen mask supplying 100% oxygen under positive pressure, the pressure would need to rise to at least 19 kPa. At 24 kPa, a simple mask supplying oxygen would already suffice. We know similar pressures on Earth from the highest peaks of the Himalaya mountains. However, in order to really have a second Earth, the pressure needs to be raised to at least 50 kPa minimum. In a quite recent paper called Inventory of CO2 Available for Terraforming Mars from 2018, link in the description, scientists analyzed if Mars even has enough carbonates in the polar caps or in the soil, which, if released, would allow to reach such pressures. Well, it turns out that only 0.6% of necessary carbon dioxide is present in the polar caps. So, really sorry, Elon, but nuking Mars won't work. Which proves that even geniuses can be wrong from time to time. A further 0.5% could be obtained from clathrates, which is a snow-like crystalline substance composed of water ice and carbon dioxide, 1.2% from minerals, and a further 4% by releasing adsorbed CO2 from the Martian soil. So in total, we would only be able to reach 6.9% of the necessary carbon from all available sources. But fortunately, there might be a way to overcome this. Because the paper also states that there are carbonates, so-called deep carbonates, present very deep in Mars's crust and mantle, which are currently not accessible by any present-day or near-future technology. To release these deep carbonates, this would require some serious future technology. But even only releasing the 6.9% would already prove quite challenging as it is. And there are two further big problems which would need to be solved.
2. Lack of magnetic field. You know that Mars is unfortunately too small to have retained a molten core, which on Earth allows for the formation of a molten iron dynamo in the core, which in turn creates a magnetic field strong enough to protect us from the high energy particles of the solar wind. Mars being so small, the dynamo ceased functioning long ago, having cooled too fast. Thus, Mars now lacks a protective magnetic field. So the solar wind is constantly stripping off Mars' atmosphere. According to data from MAVEN, Mars has lost in this way at least 80 kilopascal of CO2 pressure during the course of the last billions of years. And it is still losing atmosphere at a speed of 1 to 2 kilograms per second. Mars' atmosphere weighs 2.5 times 10 to the 16 kilograms. So Mars will lose another 10% of its atmosphere in the next 10 million years. Therefore, releasing large quantities of CO2 from the Martian soil, crust, or mantle into the atmosphere would have to overcome this effect. Sure, the effect is quite small as we saw, but in order to have a stable atmosphere, which doesn't need constant replenishment, it would be really good to also have a magnetic field, right? Fortunately, there is a good idea out there to achieve this. We could, for example, arrange a very strong magnet at the Mars Sun Lagrange point L1, as proposed by NASA scientist Jim Green in 2017. This magnetic dipole satellite would have to create a field strength of 1 to 2 Tesla, so a really strong magnetic field. This would, of course, require, as you can imagine, a quite potent energy source and comes with its own problems, which would need its own video to talk about. But this solution is probably doable. This strong magnet would then deflect the solar wind just enough, being 320 Mars radii from Mars, so that the solar wind would circumvent Mars, and therefore not stripping it anymore of its atmosphere. This solution would also drastically reduce the radiation on Mars from high-energy solar wind particles. But we would still have to solve another problem, namely.
3. The low gravity problem. Mars's surface gravity is, as we know, slightly below 38% of Earth's. While it is not certain yet how detrimental this will be to the long-term health of future Martians, one thing we do know. In order to achieve a thick atmosphere with a pressure of 50 kilopascal or more, the atmosphere would have to reach very far above the surface of the planet. Even now, the scale height of Mars's atmosphere is 11 kilometers, which is more than that of Earth's 8.5 kilometers. The scale height is, by the way, the height at which the atmospheric pressure has decreased by a factor of E, E being the irrational Euler's number of 2.718, rounded to 3 decimal values. So even at Mars's low atmospheric pressure of 0.6 kilopascal, the atmosphere being so thin still reaches further into space because of the very low gravity, which is also a reason why Mars is losing atmosphere quite easily. Probably a magnetic shield at L1, as previously mentioned, would suffice to overcome this problem. Even with the weaker gravity of Mars, the planet would then be able to hold onto its atmosphere. However, unfortunately, there are still more problems to solve.
4. The nitrogen problem. Let's say we manage in the far future to release the deep carbonates, and together with the L1 magnetic dipole shield, Mars would slowly get a CO2 atmosphere of up to 0.5 Earth atmospheric pressure. So the pressure at a height of around 5,000 meters above sea level on Earth, which people might be able to get used to after a long period of acclimatization. Then we would introduce some bacteria, which would release vast amounts of oxygen into the atmosphere. All the oxygen atmosphere on Earth was created by cyanobacteria, starting already 3.85 billion years ago, and accelerating around 1 billion years ago in the Great Oxygenation event. But a pure oxygen atmosphere is dangerous because things burn really easily as oxygen is so reactive. A staggering 78% of Earth's atmosphere actually consists of nitrogen, not oxygen. Oxygen currently only makes up for 21% of Earth's atmosphere. Therefore, in order to have stuff not explode or catch fire too often on a future hypothetical terraformed Mars, we need vast quantities of nitrogen. While there's only very little nitrogen in the rocks of Mars, there's fortunately a lot of nitrogen in the outer solar system, especially in the Kuiper Belt. If we would divert a few dwarf planets from the outer solar system by attaching massive fusion-powered tugs to them and get them onto a collision course with Mars, we would not only get massive amounts of nitrogen released into the Martian atmosphere, but no, those dwarf planets would also bring us vast amounts of water. Plus, the collisions would actually heat up Mars, releasing a lot of deep carbonates from the crust and mantle into the atmosphere. Now, of course, these collisions must be extremely precise and carefully planned, not to endanger the future Martian bases or Martian cities. And the chunks should also not be too large. Therefore, it would be advisable to have the dwarf planets disassembled into smaller chunks by a giant fleet of some automated drones. And as the dwarf planets also possess large amounts of water, we would increase Mars' water reserves at the same time. The dwarf planet Eris, for example, is supposed to have a sub-ocean of liquid water, heated up by internal radioactive decay. Okay then, so giant magnetic dipole shield at L1, redirecting and disassembling quite gigantic dwarf planets. Easy peasy. But wait, there's still one more problem to solve.
5. The perchlorate problem. We know that Mars's soil contains a quite high concentration of perchlorates, namely a mass concentration of 0.5%. Perchlorates being a chemical based on bonds of 4 oxygen and 1 chlorine ion. These levels would be quite toxic to humans if inhaled and also unhealthy for plants. In fact, not many plants would be able to withstand perchlorates at all. Only a few plants, such as Eichhornia crassipes, would be able to grow in the Martian soil at all. But if we want a terraformed Mars, we want to be able to walk around outside without oxygen mask, and also want to have plants and trees grow in the soil. And we also don't want to inhale toxic Martian dust into our lungs when being outside, especially considering that Mars is a very dusty place, with giant dust storms stirring up gigantic amounts of dust into the atmosphere. So then what to do? Well, if we would be in the later stages of terraforming, so we would have overcome all of the previously mentioned obstacles, we could introduce bacteria which live off perchlorates. Newer research, linked to a paper in the description, indicates that in fact some strands of bacteria can live off perchlorates and reduce the perchlorate concentration in the soil over time. These bacteria would first have to reduce the perchlorate concentration in the Martian soil significantly. Then at some point we would introduce some genetically modified cyanobacteria, which would create giant amounts of oxygen. Only quite a lot later then could we introduce plants. But taking all the previous points into account, we can see that terraforming Mars won't be easy. There are quite a few technical challenges which need to be overcome. Can it be even done? Well, at some point in the further future, probably yes. Every single one of the mentioned problems could be overcome with the necessary level of technological advancement. But of course, for that, we would need a very big and well-established space infrastructure in the entire solar system, with huge ships and bases even in the outer solar system. So we don't see a project of this magnitude being started before the 22nd or 23rd century. But we think that as long as something is technologically doable, humans will attempt to do it. It's in our nature.
And if you want to know the top 10 reasons which make Mars so compelling to colonize, you can check out our previous video right here.
So then, thanks for watching the JS Space Report, and I would say, see you next time and on to the future.
Top reason. Okay, I cannot say it again.
Reasons were... Look, I can also not say.